Samuel, tout va bien?
Ça a l'air d'aller. Pour l'instant, ça va.
Alors, il y a un peu d'écho, il y a un peu de bruit, donc on va. Ok. Alors, juste après commencer, on va switcher nos micros, il n'y a pas de souci.
Ok.
Ok, we can start at 9, normally at 10 o'clock, ok? Ok, we have 6 minutes. The presentation, you can do it, of course, in English. But if you have some problems, if you have some issues, we can switch to French. For if you have some problems, it's not a problem. We can translate anything. Okay, the two languages are acceptable. Normally, Spanish as well, and Euskal language, as well. But, the most important is to be understood and exchange in very good conditions. I think I'm confident that it will be okay for you and for us.
Yeah.
I guess within the team here, we cover many variety of languages.
Yes, yes. very spanned word. Okay, I used to speak three minoritary languages. Without any utilization in the world, except to share some conversations with native people. But I think any additional language is like a new Windows, your new neighborhood. You can exchange, see, and you can make the light entering to your home. And the language is the eyes. I think it's the eyes of society.
Can you hear me, please?
Bien sûr, Lionel, bien sûr. Yes.
I would like to know if everybody is connected.
Yeah. Normally, we have okay, Haché, Jorge, okay, Olivier, okay, Samir. Okay, normally. Right.
Perfect.
Florine is connected. Okay.
So, do you have any problem to hear us or? To see the slides, just let us know. And if we are ready, Mr. President, you have the floor.
Well, I have the word. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for everybody. I'd like to start in French language because it's an official presentation in French country. By it's the University of Bordeaux, which is hosting the doctoral studies related to this PhD defense. Then just a few words in French and voilà, we will switch in English. Donc, Monsieur Samuel Jupin, mes collègues m'ont fait l'honneur et le plaisir de me désigner comme président de votre thèse, de défense de thèse plus exactement. Cette thèse a été co-encadrée en co-tutelle entre le professeur Lionel Vecchio et le professeur Tapia Otegui, des Good Pronunciation, qui vient de l'Université du Pays Basque. Nous avons des deux rapporteurs qui sont M. Solsonar Jorge et M. Yo Florin, respectivement l'Université nationale del Sur Argentine, si je ne me trompe pas, et de Aalborg Université de Danemark, très connue. Le professeur Chougui est aussi membre de votre jury en tant qu'examinateur, il vient de Strathclyde. Nous avons ici bien sûr des spécialistes et de l'électronique de puissance et du contrôle. Ensuite, le représentant de l'Université du Pays Basque sera M. Hachi Zubizarreta et le représentant de l'école doctorale de Bordeaux, M. Olivier Bria, et moi-même, Sadir Bacha, donc de l'Université de Grenoble-Alpes, bon, qui préside, mais qui aura aussi le loisir de vous questionner. Vous avez à peu près 45 minutes sur lesquelles vous pouvez faire le choix de nous présenter les éléments qui sont les plus saillants de votre présentation de thèse. En vous remerciant. You have 45 minutes, around 45 minutes, to present us the main results of your PhD dissertation. Please, start when you want.
Okay. Well, first of all, good morning to everyone, and thank you very much for being here today. So my name is Samuel Jupin, as said earlier, and I'm going to present this thesis titled Advanced Control of Multilevel Power Converters for Weak Grid Applications. So this thesis is the result of a cooperation between Estia and the University of the Basque Country, and it was led under the direction of Lionel Vecchio and Gerardo Tapia Otaegui. So the presentation will follow the this path. First of all, we'll do a short context and motivation leading to a state of the art, from which we will determine the problematic of the thesis, leading to two ideas, switch state space representation and optimization algorithms, leading to a developed controller, which we will study in simulation before concluding. So, with the massive integration of renewable energy sources in the grid, many changes are necessary in this distribution grid. In particular, the traditional grid, which has a very linear flow and unidirectional flow of energy, is not adapted to the complex to the complexity added by the renewable energy sources. A common solution is the microgrid solution. It is a different architecture of grid, which is much more flexible and complex, able to manage more complexity in its flow of energy. In this situation, the power converters are particularly important. In fact, power converters are the main interface of these grids, and they will interface the different elements of the grids, and the ability to control these power converters is crucial for the good operation of microgrids. So power converters, generally speaking, they will manage the connection between the two different systems they are connecting. And they can do so by selecting one out of three or more different positions of connection, leading to different variations in the continuous electric signals. So there are many different kinds of multi-level power converters. They are adapted to specific applications. They are designed for specific applications. But generally speaking, all multi-level power converters have better waveforms and so a better harmonic content than the two-level counterparts. And they will have reduced electromagnetic interference, but also they can support higher level of powers with the same level of components. So the family of multi-level power converters can be divided in two smaller families, integrated multi-level converters and multi-cell converters. The family of integrated multi-level converters leads to neutral point clamp topology and flying capacitor topology. And the multi-cell converters lead to cascaded edge bridge topologies and modular multi-level converters. And we will here in this thesis study mainly the neutral point clamped flying capacitor and cascaded edge bridge topology. One of the main issues of multi-level power converters is that they are slightly more expensive than their two-level counterparts. And also, and here this is the main point of this thesis, they put a bigger burden on the controller. The control is a bit more complex when it comes to multi-level converters than for two-level power converters. So we will study three topologies as expected. So first of all, the neutral point clamp topology, it is one of the most common topologies, and it can be identified by its elemental leg, here cycled in blue, which can be recognized thanks to the diodes serving as a neutral point clamp. So this topology is adapted to back-to-back applications and can be used in a large variety of applications. Then the flying capacitor topology is slightly different. Its elemental leg shows a capacitor inside it, which adds a small inertia to the general system. This inertia is very unique and can only be found in this topology. And finally, the cascaded edge bridge topology, which is a modular topology and can be extended to very high number of levels, up to 11 or even more in the state of the art. And we can recognize here the edge bridge, the typical edge bridge topology on the main leg. So here, in this example, we've seen the three-level topologies for each of them. And and we will abbreviate New Turbine Clamped by NPC, Flying Capacitor by FC, and Cascade Edge Bridge by CHB in the rest of this presentation. So one of the biggest problems here that we can see directly is that the control, the form of the control for these converters is the open or closed state of the switches. And so we have to manipulate continuous objectives, continuous requirements, continuous signals coming from the electrical side of the converter, but also we need to manage these discrete actions on the switching states. And so usually to perform this translation, we use a modulation block, which is used as an interface between the controller, which is only functioning, operating with continuous values and objectives, to the system that is controlled with discrete values coming from the switches. So this modulation block is very important, and there are a large variety as well of different modulation strategies to adapt to different objectives and to different situations. So we can see here a quick overview of modulation strategies. And generally speaking, the lower the frequency, the better the efficiency, and the higher the frequency is, the better precision we will have, so with a better harmonics content. The most common modulation strategies we will find will be space vector modulation, abbreviated by SVM, and the sinusoidal pulse width modulation, SPWM. Okay. So from what we've seen, the traditional control of multilevel power converters is a combination from extracted from the requirements for the system, all of them. We will end up with objectives related to the interfacing function and objectives related to the switching nature. So we will see here the example for linear typical linear control structure. So typically here, we can see in Solomon the linear control, which is only continuous and operating with continuous values. And then in yellow, we will see the modulation block and different transformations used to handle this translation from the control to the actual control with the switching states. So now, what happens if we want to increase the level of intelligence of this control? We have two possibilities. The first possibility is to add intelligence to the modulation block or to add intelligence to the control block. Both of them can be done separately, but once we do modifications on the modulation, we need to modify the control block, and vice versa. There is also another possibility, which is to include the modulation block directly into the control block. In this case, we think it is more interesting because it adds intelligence and the possibility to act on all aspects of the power converter directly with only one controller, one control structure. Which leads us to our research problem. How can we conciliate the nature and the function of multilevel power converters? And how can we forge one controller to rule all different topologies and applications of multilevel power converters? And finally, is it possible to regroup all the different control requirements we've seen into only one controller? To do so, we decided to focus on model predictive control, which is a control architecture especially strong when it comes to multiple input, multiple output control problems. It is a control architecture which is very complete because it can handle a large variety of control problems, and it can also handle nonlinearity. However, it is more complex than traditional control, and it puts a huge computation burden on the physical system in the end. So the most usual form of model predictive control, which we call MPC, is a combination of state-space representation and linear quadratic optimization. The issue with state-space representation and, of course, the optimization that follows, is that switching actions cannot be represented in these models, which in turn leads us back to modulation. if we want to use the usual form of model predictive control, we need modulation. And so this is a no for us, because we want to include all of the control objectives and requirements directly into one controller. So we need to develop a new model predictive control strategy adapted to multi-level power converters. So first of all, let's talk about modeling. So we'll try with a simple example. So here we can see the neutral point clamped elemental leg. And we can see first a very first possibility of connection. We can see here, for example, that if the switches S1 and S2 are closed, but the switches S3 and S4 are open, we have a connection between the phase to the point P here, and which leads us to this set of equation. So only the Kirchhoff laws directly used on the different interesting points. So now another case of connection. So this time S1 and S2 are open and S3 and S4 are closed. We can see here that the equations change because we are now connected to the point N, and of course the equations are adapted. Now third and last possibility here for this topology, S1 and S4 are open and S2 and S3 are closed. In this situation, we are connecting the phase to the ground, leading to the set of equation 3. Now, the general methodology of our strategy will be to establish continuous linear models for each possibility of connection, then associate a parameter to each of these situations, and aggregate all those subsystems into one global system using combinatory rules. So going back to
forgive
the example.
Just forgive me, just we yes. have some issues with yeah. Professor Shu. We okay. still in the slide, I don't remember, 8 maybe.
Okay.
Is it possible to fix that?
You know? Yeah, okay, just jump to 18 now.
Okay.
Okay, it's okay. Please continue.
Yeah. Okay, no problem.
Yes. I don't know why.
Yes.
Okay, so we are coming back to our application on the example. We can see here that we have the combination of the three sets of equations we used before, and we associate to each of them a parameter. So we call when we connect to the point P, we will use SP. When we connect to N, we will call it SN, and to the ground, S0. And we have this combinatory rule that states that we can only have one of them at a time, and there is only these three possibilities, which means that SP plus SN plus S0 is equal to 1. And we can see here that if we sum and aggregate all the three cases, all the three systems, we will end up with a resulting system of equation 8, in which the information on the switching state of the topology is added. So this was our main goal. Which leads us now to the more real case when we will add filters and other components, which will entail differential equations leading to state space representation. So for each possibility, we will have a state space representation. For your information here, we studied in this thesis mainly the L, LC, and LCL filters, but the results can be extended to any other filter if necessary, and other systems connected to the converter. And when it comes, once we have all these subsystems, these state space representations for one, for each and every positions, connections, we can parameterize this, and this will lead to what we call a switch state space representation. So we can see here the one of the general forms of switch state space representation. The information on the switches is included directly inside the matrices of the state space representation. So we define the canonical form for all multi-level power converters. We can see here, so it is a combination of the different subsystems. And we can see in the A matrix, the dynamics of the connected systems, and also the dynamics of the inner system, so the switching operation of the topology. And in the E matrix and the D vector, we will end up with the disturbances and the uncontrolled inputs. So now that we have established this canonical form and this general form of modeling, we can study stability and controllability. So first of all, stability. We can see that stability will be related to the action inputs, but they are directly included inside the A matrix. So this will end up to this is a big problem. It is possible to determine the stability for each and any of the subsystems using linear methods such as eigenvalues, but it is not possible to conclude directly on the stability of the global system. Typically, there are two main reasons to that. It's that even if all subsystems are stable, it is possible that a certain input, certain sequence of input, will lead to an unstable global system. It's also possible that even if all subsystems are unstable, it may exist one sequence of control that will lead to stability for the general system. So we cannot directly conclude on stability. Therefore, we will need to introduce another notion, which is called stabilizability. Stabilizability defines the existence of a sequence of control that stabilizes the system. So it is a bit complicated to determine exactly this existence of a sequence. We only need to find one, but it's difficult to find all of them. It does not define this way. So we have found a sufficient condition to determine stabilizability of a switch tight space representation as we have presented it. So if we find a linear combination of the subsystems that leads to a global system that is stable, then we can prove the existence of a sequence of control that will stabilize the system. So we will prove the stabilizability of the system. However, this is a sufficient condition and not a necessary condition, which means if we do not find this sequence, this combination, it does not necessarily mean that the system is not stabilizable. And also, finding this linear combination can only be done thanks to brute force, so we have to bulldoze our way through the combinations until we find one or do not find one, it depends. So now, when it comes to controllability, we have the same issue. So it is possible to establish a sufficient condition on controllability of the global system, which is if we study the controllability of each subsystem and determine that all of them are controllable, then the final system is controllable. But this is also a sufficient condition, meaning that if all the subsystems are not controllable, it does not mean anything on the controllability of the general system. Then we have decided to focus on finding a necessary and sufficient condition here for this situation, which led us to a combinatory controllability matrix for the global system. So it's a combination of all the controllability matrix of all the different subsystems. And this situation leads to a very imposing, huge matrix, which is often very difficult to compute precisely, and only in order to find the rank of this matrix. So both of these situations, we need to find use a compromise between the two to determine the controllability correctly of the system, of the global system. So now that we've seen that we have a general modeling methodology. And this general modeling methodology, we've studied stability and controllability, and now we can talk about how to use optimization on this methodology. So if we start from a given point in time, we'll have the states of the system, we'll call them x of t0, and from this point of time, there are different possibilities that can be explored. So for example, here in this figure, we can see three different routes, paths, and from they lead to a new point, and for each point we'll have a different tree of possibilities and so on, leading to a global tree of possibilities for the situation. So seeing this tree, we end up with a graph of possibilities to which we can associate a weight to each branch of the tree, which means that we can include information about the control objectives and control requirements directly into this graph of possibilities. So now we only have to minimize the total cost leading from the beginning, the initial point, to the final level we want to reach. And this will be done thanks to shortest path algorithms, which are algorithms often used when trying to find the best path from one point to another, typically on maps. So here we will treat some examples of shortest path algorithms. So maybe, we'll treat three of them. So first of all, we'll try to see them on an example, illustrate them on an example. This is the example, so this is a tree already weighted. And the objective will be to perform the minimum number of operations to solve the problem and to find the optimal path. So we'll see three methods. The first one will be brute force. So brute force, it will simply compute all the different possibilities and find the determine the best one. So this strategy has the maximum number of computation, but it also leads to the optimal solution. We can also see its counterpart, its opposite, which is a greedy algorithm. Greedy algorithm will not check all the tree, all the possibilities. It will only see at one point what is the best solution now, and then it will take this direction and then change from this new point. So the number of operations is minimal. We cannot do less operations than this to solve this problem. However, it does not lead necessarily to the optimal solution. For example, here, we do not have the same solution with the greedy algorithms and with the brute force. In this example, the greedy algorithm does not lead to the optimal solution. And then the third algorithm we will present here is the Dijkstra algorithm. This algorithm uses an update of the tree. It starts with a certain level, it starts at a certain point in the tree, and at this point, it will calculate the best possibility and add this possibility to the tree it knows. And from this new tree that it knows, it will find the next best possibility and add it, and continue until we reach the desired point. So this solution needs less steps than brute force, but it also leads to optimal solution. This is the reason why we decided to focus on a similar algorithm called A-star algorithm, which is an adaptation of this algorithm. So to implement correctly the control objective, we have to check how to express the cost function into that we use in this tree. So from what we've seen so far, there are no conditions on this cost function. Everything is possible. We can add some tracking objectives. We can have some constraints. We can have linear objectives or non-linear objectives. There is no reason to limit ourselves to one or other aspect. So this leads us to a general form of the cost function, which is a combination, a linear combination of different subcosts that will represent each of them one objective or one control requirement. So finally, we will end up with a controller that will combine the general methodology and modeling methodology that we use, which takes place for presentation, with the algorithm, optimization algorithm that we have developed. So here we can see it will use a combination of finite control set model predictive control, so finite control set MPC. We can see here the general operation of finite control set MPC. What is important is that it enables the system to have more time to perform all its computations. This is the main objective of this structure, to give more time and so to improve the feasibility of the controller. And on the right, we can see the different, we can see directly the algorithms that we deployed to optimize the results. So the most important parts are the block called identify the destinations and update the tree. But we can talk about that later. So how can we evaluate the behavior of our controller? So first of all, the number of predictions, which is related to the general speed of resolution, is really important because it determines all the feasibility of the controller. And it is not easy to determine and to establish the relation between the tree, the cost function, and the situation of the system it is not easy to directly know what will be the impact on the general speed. We've determined that it is not important, well, the norm used is not important, it's indifferent to use one norm, quadratic norm or infinity norm. There have been no differences in computation. But most importantly, we can see that the number of possibilities is explosive. The tree of possibilities will grow very, very fast, leading to a high number of possibilities, and it is difficult for the controller, for the algorithm, to reach, well, to predict far into the future, into the horizon of possibilities. So far, we've been limited to control horizon of 3 or 4. So then now we can see the sensitivity. We will study in simulation first the sensitivity and the robustness before going to case studies. So the sensitivity will be the impact of the expression of the cost function, so the impact of the coefficients alpha 1, alpha 2, and alpha I, and so on the results and on the general performance of the controller. So generally speaking, we can say that the higher is this coefficient, the more importance is given to the subcost associated. However, when the number of different subcosts increases, it will be more difficult to clearly state what will be the impact on the global state function, cost function. So for example here, we treated a very simple situation with only 2 subcosts. One is called gamma switch related to the number of switching actions. Its objective is to reduce the number of switching actions, and another one on tracking. And in this situation, we have this figure. So we have changed the value of alpha switch, the coefficients related to the subcost for the switching actions. And we can see that the higher this value is, the more, the less switching actions there are. And we can see here, for example, that it is decreasing slowly until it reaches the zero number of switching operations, which is not necessarily what we intend, but that also highlights the necessity to correctly weight this cost function. Now, when it comes to robustness will be the study of the impact of model error on the performance. So we will do let me start again. We will change the model used and the real system we will study. So for example, if we add a model error inside the controller, we will try to see if the controller still manages to control correctly the system, which is different from what it is predicting. So from what we've seen so far, even when the error tracking, the error percentage increases widely, the tracking results are rather stable. So this is this means it is a very robust controller, and this is typical of model predictive control in general. So now we will go on with the case studies. So we will study 4 different situations. The first situation will be an inverter standalone situation, then a rectifier application, a grid-connected application, and a grid-forming application. The first 3 cases will be studied for both for the 3-level NPC topology, for the 3-level filing capacitor topology, and for the 3-level cascaded edge bridge topology. The grid-forming study was only performed for 3-level NPC topology, but the results can be extended to all other topologies. So we can see here that the arrow of complexity is growing the farther we go. So let us begin with the inverter standalone situation. Sorry. In this situation, which is the simplest one, the converter is connected to an ideal DC link and DC voltage generator on the DC side, and on the AC side it is connected to 3 loads only. There is no grid connected to it. We will see 3 different cases in this situation. First of all, a case when the loads are balanced. then a case when the load are unbalanced. And finally, we will try to input some very unusual reference profiles to put more stress on the controller. So the objectives in this situation will always be to have a good tracking of the currents at the point of common coupling for the loads. And we will also want to have high efficiency, which means that we want to minimize the number of switching actions. So this is the form of the cost function we will use here. And we will use the same form of cost function for all three cases. So in the first case, when the loads are balanced, we can see here on the figure on the left that the tracking is performed correctly. And we can see, more importantly, that a figure on the right, the harmonic content is especially clean in this situation. Now, when it comes to an unbalanced load, the results are absolutely the same. We have a good tracking of for the currents, but in this situation, the current references were specially designed to have a balanced voltage situation. And considering that here we had a 10% difference for each phase of the for each load, leading to around 1 kilowatt difference in power in each load. So we can see here that the balancing of the three voltages is performed correctly with good total harmonic distortion. Now, if we see the third situation, which is the most unusual situation, with different profiles, a bit more difficult to follow, we can see here that even if we change the amplitude of the signal of the references, even if we change the bias, even if we change the frequency, and even if we change both of them at the same, both or thrice of them at the same time, three of them at the same time, we had good results for tracking for each one of them. For each situation, all the stress we tried to put on the controller was vanished. And we can see on the figure on the right that the modulation orders change in function of these different objectives, and that proves in a way that the controller is able to handle correctly these switching orders and switching actions. So now let's try to add some more complexity to the global control problem. We'll now study the grid-connected inverter situation. We can see here that it's the same situation as earlier. We simply added a grid, a phase voltage generator. And so now this time the objective will be to track the active power, to track the reactive power. And we still need to have high efficiency, but we also need to add two informations, one on the balanced current and another one on sinusoidal form of the currents. So the balanced currents will be added on the form here on equation 17, and the information for the sinusoidal currents, the objective on the sinusoidal currents, is on the form of equation 18. This leads us, in the end, to the general form in equation 19, which is a combination of all of these different objectives. So we can see here the first results we obtained, and we can see that on the figure on the right, we can see that the currents obtained are in fact sinusoidal and balanced. There is no issue on this part. However, we have found some sort of coupling effect on the power active and reactive powers. And even so, we could not solve exactly the origin of this coupling effect. We can determine a method adapted to minimize this effect and basically solve it. So here we used this, it was a modification in the cost function, and using this modification we end up with this result which erase this coupling effect. So now that we've seen the AC side of the objectives, we can focus on the DC side of the objectives. So now we'll study a rectifier operation. So this time the objectives are similarly to the very first case efficiency and tracking, but tracking not of the currents of the AC side, but of the voltages of the DC side. So we'll have different cost functions, different expressions in function of the different topologies, because so far the three topologies we've studied had the exact same connection on the AC side. However, the DC side is very different for the three topologies. So we need to adapt the cost function to these different expressions and these different topologies. So there is one cost function for each topology. So the results show a very fast tracking result, especially for the neutral point clamped topology. But they also show that the three topologies do not have the same behavior exactly. And this was to be expected because the three topologies are different and have different DC links. Okay, so now that we've seen the AC side and the DC side, we'll try to combine the objectives of the two in one more complex situation. So this is the grid forming application. So we can see on the left the general scheme that we will be using. So we will find the converter connected to a grid formed of four loads, two resistive loads, one capacitive load and one inductive load. The one of the resistive loads and the two inductive and capacitive loads can be connected or disconnected to the grid to create events. And also on the DC side, we have an hybrid storage system, and we want to be able to decide which part of the storage system will deliver more or less power. So these informations, we will implement them directly in the cost function as explained on the figure on the right. So we will have the objectives on the DC side, which include the power that the two, well, the global storage system has to deliver, and a coefficient that will express the repartition of this of the energy from one or the other storage system. Then we will have the objectives on the AC side. So typically, we want 230 volts voltage, and we want 50 hertz frequency. So all this information will be included in the references for the AC part. And so we can see here that the combination of all of this leads to, first of all, a good following of the objectives on power and reactive power. So the needs of the different loads are satisfied correctly. And also we can see that from the DC side, we were able to separate the two sources and to allocate more or less energy, to take more or less energy from one or the other. And when we changed the repartition of energy, we managed to not make it change the general total energy given to the grid. Good. So finally, what we've done here in this thesis works is that we defined a modeling methodology for all multi-level power converters. We studied theoretically these models, leading to results on stability, stabilizability, and controllability. We developed optimization and MPC algorithms. We proved the system in simulation, the operation of the global final controller in simulation. And we've seen that with different situations, different topologies, different cost functions, different control requirements, we were always able to, well, the controller was always able to handle the different situations, which means that this controller, the general form of this controller, is universal and it can adapt itself to such situation. So, for the future, we would love to improve these optimization algorithms because, as we said earlier, we can only reach 3 to 4 steps of optimization. And it would be really interesting to be able to go further, but it impacts greatly the feasibility of this controller. We also need to validate the simulation results experimentally, and we need to develop the theoretical studies on cost function and on the weighting of this cost function. because this is where the control objectives and control requirements are implemented. So if we want to add more intelligence to the system, we need to understand better the cost function design and weighting. So this thesis works led to the publication to four publications. Three of them were conference papers, and one of them is an article in Electrical Power Systems Research. So I would like to thank you for your attention, and I leave you. I give you back the speak.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jupin. I think you took less than 40 minutes, but everything is present here. I'd like to anticipate the debate by congratulating you for the quality of this presentation, and the times and everything for me is clear. Now is the time for questions and exchanges with the jury members. I'd like to start with the first reviewer, with Professor Solsona Jorge, by giving him the word. Please, Jorge, the words are yours.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Very well.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to thank Bordeaux and UPB universities for the invitation to be a member of this jury. In addition, I would like to thank you for a very good dissertation. The first question, taking into consideration the grid connected inverter case, another compensation was included. Did you assume the measurement is ideal? In other words, is there are no bias and high frequency uncertainties in the measurement?
So far in simulation, we always kept an ideal measurement theory, hypothesis. We always used ideal measurements. Only when we studied robustness did we add some variations.
Okay. Another question. In the controller design, sensor bandwidth and actuator speed should be considered. For instance, device dead time, etc. Roughly speaking, a very fast control algorithm is not useful when sensor and actuators do work slowly. Now the question. Do you think industry is willing to pay this price for improving the whole performance of a grid tie or grid forming inverters?
it's a
general question.
Yeah. I mean, the main interest here is that this this new form of controller is very flexible, and only one form could be used for different applications, and we would not need to change it and to pay it again. I mean, each time we want to change. So I cannot assure you that industry would be willing to pay for this kind of controller, which is, of course, a bit more expensive. But I think there are enough good reasons for them to be interested, at least.
The next question. Regarding the sensors, could virtual sensors, estimation algorithms, observer, etc., to be a solution for reducing the cost?
The cost, you mean the cost of the global
the cost
controller?
Of the system. Could you use observers? Do you know observer estimation algorithms?
We can.
And disturbances?
Of course, observability and observers can be developed to minimize the number of sensors. Yes, absolutely. And I think model predictive control, because the models they do not necessarily use all of the sensors. We can add this information coming from the observability of the system and, of course, include it directly into the prediction of the model control.
Yeah. And the last question is also a general question. Do you know silicon carbide technology? Did this name sound... silicon carbide technology for devices?
silicon carbon. Well, it's for the general.
It's a general question.
It's for the general
for the
operation for the switches. Yes. Okay. So I don't necessarily know very well the different types of switching technologies, but I know that in parallel there are different paths of research to improve the operation of power converters. And even so, it was not my main focus. Yes, I have seen that there are different results coming in the last years and in the future to improve the operation of the different switching devices. And yeah, of course, this has to be included as well in, well, we can think about it, of course. When designing this control and designing the future control, we have to think about the characteristics.
I have to ask you this question differently, if Jorge permits, of course.
Yeah, okay.
Carbure in French, if you want, the problem c'est le carbure de silicium. Mm-hmm. Est-ce que quelqu'un parle de carbure de silicium ne rendrait pas obsolète certaines structures comme le NPC et d'autres? Puisque la commutation étant presque parfaite, meilleure, est-ce que ça ne remet pas en cause les structures en question?
D'où okay. I see what you mean. I mean, even if we change the capacity, the capability of the technology of the switch, of the switching technology itself, we still have to control it accurately and intelligently, I will say. And of course, this is the main objective of this controller: it's to directly handle the switching orders. And these switching orders, as long as we will need some switching orders, this type of structure is interesting.
No more questions. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jorge. Now we move to Professor Yov. Florin, please.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Well,
thank you for the presentation. Really nice summary of quite long and hard work. I will try to follow up on one of the questions from Jorge. Why this industry, or which industry may be interested in this multi-level? Are we talking about high power or low power applications?
Mm-hmm. I think that generally speaking, multi-level power converters can be used in medium to high level of powers, and they are especially interesting in terms of waveform, and they can handle higher levels of power without having more advanced technologies used inside. I think all medium to medium high level power of voltages and energy can be interested in this kind of topologies, I think.
Okay. But what will be the main advantage in this case? Why those guys really, and there is a lot of research right now, some companies are trying also to, what is the main driver for this?
The main drive for multi-level power converters? Well,
yes.
to make it, I don't know exactly. I mean, for me, what happens is that because they can have a better waveform quality and less harmonics, this is already very interesting for the industry because it will improve the quality of the energy distribution. But also, we can have a more precise control of our energy and the efficiency of the converter, and also, because we have the possibility to adapt the topology to the situation, in a lot of cases, it is more interesting to have a specialized topology for a specialized application. And two-level topologies rarely can adapt as much as multi-level topologies. And also, a final situation, I think, is reliability, because it often appears in the literature. We can see that multi-level converters often have more than one possibility to perform the connection, and so this adds reliability to the general structure, to the controlled system. So those are interesting elements. Like even if, I don't know, one switch or one element of the converter is not operating correctly, it is possible for certain topologies, not all of them. For example, for the cascaded edge bridge topology, it's very easy to add this reliability. It's a bit more difficult for the neutral point claim from what I've seen. But some of the topologies can have more reliability, for example. And so this is always interesting in the industry.
Yes, thank you. I have one specific question related to page 82 in your report. You found some unstable modes.
Yeah.
At some point when you did that study.
Yeah.
And then are those modes controllable?
Well, it depends, but I mean, not all unstable modes were uncontrollable. Not all of them.
Then
but
which ones may be controllable? I was missing a little bit of discussion here. To link maybe the modes to some parts of the topology. And then to point that maybe some of them you can not control them, they are there and you have to live with, and then some of the modes might be controllable and how. But yeah, it's just something that you may think in the next
okay, in the next steps. Yeah, it's true that so far in the tree of possibilities, we always considered all the different connection possibilities. And this is not necessary for the in the optimization. We could consider that some of them are not interesting because, for example, unstable or uncontrollable. And yes, this could be included directly into the controller. Yeah, could be interesting.
You pointed clearly in the slides that MPC it's quite complex. And then can you make some practical consideration on how this MPC will go into a microcontroller, DSP board or something? And then can you run it actually and not have overruns?
So from what we've tried, we did not try directly on the DSP, but we've checked that it was feasible to perform all the operations directly in the time slot given. And I tried to program it in C++, and there were no issues, because generally speaking, it's just it's a tree of possibilities with very simple operations. And as long as we perform them in the necessary time, there should not be any clocking issue. But it's true that this is the main problem with the feasibility of this controller. We need to have high-performing chips, well, systems, to implement this kind of controller.
Okay. And do you have a timeline when we should be able to see some results from the lab? Will you continue to work on this?
Well, I don't know exactly, but yeah, of course, it would be very interesting to be able to validate this all these simulation with results to prove that it's really interesting in experimentally. Yeah, and I don't know exactly how it will take place so far, but yeah, it would be absolutely very interesting.
And then one last generic questions. After all these years of working hard, what will you do different if you will start again all this work?
What would I do differently?
Well, yes.
I mean, I think one of the main focuses here was put on three topologies. I think I would try to expand a little more and to be able to say that to have results on more types of topologies, to have more universality, to be a bit more universal in the approach. But also, well, of course, I would change myself. I mean, sometimes I don't work very well, and so. So yeah, no, but generally speaking, in terms of the path of the research, personally, I would improve the way I did the bibliography, because it was a bit hard for me, and it was not performed exactly in the perfect way, the best way. But otherwise, yeah, I think apart from not losing as much time on errors, things are, I don't have to change too much. But yeah, adding some universality, and yeah, it's I think it's okay for me.
Okay, thank you. So that's all from my side.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Florine. We have time now for other questions. If you want to add new questions during the debate, don't hesitate. It's an open debate, I can say. Okay, Professor Xu, please, the word is yours.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I had some problem with Teams. Seems my screen doesn't flash as frequently as it should be. So I'm frequently switching between the YouTube channel and the Teams, but the voice is good. So I think that's the main thing.
We can see you, we can hear you well.
Okay, so thanks, Samuel, for the presentation and for the summary.
Mm-hmm.
I have a couple, actually, clearly, I would like to get your opinion from, you know. The title of your thesis,
mm-hmm.
yeah, is for weak grid applications.
Yeah.
So depending on how you interpret weak grid, I've not seen any direct, mentioning of weak grid in some of your, case studies.
Yep.
So can you elaborate a bit more on this?
Yep. of course, the weak grid application is the main reason, the main motivation for all these works. And so far, when we studied in simulation, there are still some modifications to be brought to be able to tackle really correctly the different weak grids application we studied and we tried to do. So far, the results were not as good as expected. There is still some work on the cost function to correctly take everything into account. And so we did not focus too strongly on this in the presentation and in the manuscript. But yeah, this is the main motivation, and it was the main objective all along. The results are still not perfect yet. So, but this is the main objective, and from what we've seen, because the grid itself is not modeled into the predictive control, into the models of the predictive control, there should not be too many difficulties when implementing it on a strong grid or on a weak grid. However, we've seen in simulations that there were some modifications, and we are still studying how to correctly adapt ourselves to these modifications.
Right. Okay. So based on your understanding and the experience, knowledge you gained from the work, what do you see the main challenges for converter connecting to weak grid?
Well, the main issue in general is that when we modify, when we input more or less power and energy to this grid, it will react, and it will change its properties. And because of that, because there is no information on this reaction in the model predictive control, sometimes it will perform an act that will modify the grid, well, the properties of the grid, and it will not necessarily understand how it changes the grid. And so it's very difficult to correctly implement this information that the properties of the grid, the voltage, amplitude, and the frequency can change and this grid, and even so, it's still trying to track correctly the objectives we give it. Sometimes there are some dynamics that are not taken into account and that are too strong for the MPC to just ignore and go through it. So this is one of the main difficulty, and one of the solutions we thought about is to add this information, to give this information to the controller. But the thing is, because the controller can only perform a prediction horizon of 3 to 4 steps, which are sample times, very, very short steps, it is very difficult to implement dynamics, electrical dynamics from the grid, which are much slower than that. So this is one of the main difficulties we've had so far. And personally, I think that the best solution for this would be to have an higher level control on top of this model predictive control, like an energy management system that will give this information to the model predictive controller to be able to include it directly into its orders, in its inputs.
Okay. So there are more work to do.
Always.
Right. Okay. So, when I, you know, read your thesis and hearing your presentation, so the converter configuration you assumed essentially is like 3 independent phases, yeah. Because you always have the DC neutral point grounded, and you have the AC side the neutral point also grounded. So effectively, you are dealing with a 3 single phase system.
Yeah.
Can I ask you why you do this way? You know, obviously, in reality, most of the system, you know, the converter system, as well as the network, you know, you will not have the common grounding point. Unless, you know, you have, the system have to supply, you know, single phase load. In that case, you might even, you know, choose to have a 4th leg, you know, on your converter. So why did you, you know, I mean, I'm not saying it's long, you know, I just want get your opinion, you know, or your thought when you start the work. Why why did you choose to go for the, you know, the system with a common grounding point? Because as you know, most of the converter will not have a, you know, grounding point at the middle point of the DC.
It's a bit difficult to answer precisely the reason, but generally speaking, when we started, I've seen a lot of different ways to model and study the multi-level power converters, and so I started quite frankly to follow one direction, and probably I focused a bit too much on this way of presentation and stayed on this topologies that we studied. And of course, the only difference is in the modeling aspect. So there is no real reason to do one more than the other from our point of view. So because it's simply a modeling modification on how to establish the Kirchhoff laws, for example, we can adapt the modeling methodology to adapt to this other way.
Okay. Yeah. I do see you will. I mean, there might have some, you know, extra you need to consider if you don't have the neutral line, because you've done some, you know, unbalanced, you know, study. Obviously. For the system you have now, you know, the 3-phase can be controlled independently. So I would say unbalancing issue is relatively easy to deal with than you have a 3-phase, you know, or what basically we call the 3-phase 3-wire system. Then all the 3-phase will be, you know, strongly coupled. Okay. Well, another one I just want to clarify. So in your simulation study, the last, I think chapter five. So how actually the model is developed? I obviously you have the MPC controller, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And the net, the converter is did you use the power system block set to to build
yes.
your converter, or you use your what you called this SSSP model, or
I use a Simulink extension for power systems. So,
okay. So the converter model is built using, you know, the switches, physical component from the Simulink library.
Yeah, exactly. All switches are included, and all the different components, capacitors and diodes and everything is made on the Simulink library. Yeah.
Right, okay. So one of the issues I see, you know, with the MPC method that you implement is the switching frequency.
Yeah.
So in your case, obviously, well, if I'm not mistaken, the switching frequency is not fixed.
No, it's not fixed.
Can you comment on how this would implicate on a practical converter design, you know, any alternative, you know, ways you would like maybe to implement for a practical, you know, converter system?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, in fact, all the time, switches have their specific switching frequency where it's better to operate at this frequency, and for this reason, usually control will lead to a switch frequency of switching fixed. Yes. And in this situation, the objective of this controller was to give the best sequence of control, and this fixed frequency was not directly taken into account, but we can only give a measurement, like it cannot overcome this value. This is the maximum value of frequency, and as long as this value of frequency is lower than the frequency of the switch, there should not be any issue. And I also agree with that, because this is not a fixed frequency, as the algorithm is now, there can be some issues with some technologies, and in this case, it can be interesting to add in the cost function some information on the number of switching actions to be performed at any on a certain time. So this means that by changing the control, the cost function and the way the tree is explored, we can give this information to the controller to force it to perform only a certain number of switches in a certain time slot, which means to fix the frequency. It is possible to include this information in the cost function, I think. We did not specially try to do it in this case, but I'm pretty sure that we can do it.
Right. Okay. Obviously, there's another issue with this, available switching frequency, or even if you fix the average frequency to be a certain number, as we have seen from the, you know, the spectra of the current, they are quite flat. Sometimes, as you know, when we design the LCL filter, we would like to tune at a specific frequency so it can be more effective. So that's one of the potential issue with, you know, this this variable frequency, or have the flat harmonic spectra. So that's something also probably, you know, need to be considered if you or someone else to take this work further. Okay, another interesting point, as you also highlighted in your presentation and also in the thesis, about it's on the offset of the active and the reactive power. I mean, it's quite interesting to see, you know, so once you compensate this, you know, 0.06, you know, times effectively, the Q on top of the P and the P on top of the Q,
Yeah.
And then all the offset disappear. I know you said further work, you know, is required. I'm just wondering whether you have any thought, which probably not mature enough to be put in the thesis, but just want to hear any thoughts you have on this.
Yeah, absolutely. This was maybe one of the biggest problem we encountered during this thesis, because it was the first moment when we did not understand when it worked and we did not understand when it didn't work. So of course this was I spent a lot of time working on that. And the main issue is that this offset, this coupling aspect, it's very easy to see it and to to devise a solution to find the value of the coupling coefficient. As we've seen, it works when we apply it. But the way we use it, we find it, is only experimentally by watching what is happening. And then we tried to express this coefficient, to find where does it come from. And it was when we did this that we realized that something was not as easy as it seemed, because all the different hints we tried, different inches we tried to follow, led to the same conclusion. This is not coming simply from this point. So there were many different aspects. For example, the inductances inside the different inductances of the systems. We thought it could be from here, but the modification of the inductive loads did not change completely, well, did not change accordingly to what we expected, this coupling effect. And then another realization was that when we changed in the cost function the horizon, the control horizon, this coupling effect changed. The higher the coupling horizon, the less there is a coupling effect. And so from this point on, I thought it was a lot more complex than what was expected, because it's a mix of optimization and prediction that there is something happening here, and I could not determine in time what exactly was the problem. But yeah, there is a problem here, and I really would like to know the reason. So far, I don't know, but it's in work.
Okay. Well, I guess we are allowed to leave something I don't know.
Well, in this case, I don't know. I mean.
Good. Thanks. Yeah. I think I probably have used more than my fair share of the time. So thanks, Sammy, for the presentation and all the useful discussion. I think that's all I want to ask at this stage.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, that's me, yeah.
Okay, Cédric?
Okay. Oui, thank you very much, Professor Chou. Thank you very much for this huge set of questions. I think it will remain some of them to my colleagues. I'll start now. We have to switch to Professor Zubi Zaretta, Asier, if you want to start your questions, please.
Thank you very much. Do you hear me okay?
Yep, I hear you.
Okay.
Well, very well.
Thank you. Well, first of all, congratulations for your presentation and the document. Particularly the presentation, I think it has been very clear. I'm not an expert on power electronics. I have followed your document quite well and understood the problems you were facing. And obviously, I extend this congratulations to your supervisors and their work. I have some questions and some comments too. I would like to start with the comments regarding the thesis, the document, because I am familiarized with the MPC controllers for some time now, and I have find some differences in what I usually explain to my students and what you have put there. In fact, it's just semantics, more or less, but just to clarify it, if I have understand it, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that you, when you argument that you are trying to introduce intelligence on your system, on your controller, that you are trying to implement a more complex one, like the MPC, where you have information on the model and use that prediction. But from the control point of view, MPC is not an intelligent control. It's not in that family of controllers.
Yeah, no, it's an optimal control. Yeah, I understand the point. Yeah.
Then it's true that the MPC is very flexible, really, really flexible. I don't know if universal would be the word. Some people, some professor told me that don't use that word. It's very, some people take it too thoroughly.
Yeah.
So it is true, but it's not only your controller, it's the framework. And the MPC is like a big family of what you can do whatever you want, as you have done. Right? So that's perfect because you have fitted to this problem. And the most critical thing for me was to try to understand how it works, because for me, the prediction or your horizon is that, you know, the number of steps you predict to the future, and you optimize that step, that number of steps. The control horizon is usually smaller and used to reduce the computational cost. That means that you have to predict 10 steps, you only compute two control actions and then maintain that constant. That's the concept of control horizon in the traditional MPC, and in the books from Camacho, from Eduardo, for instance, is how it's explained. But you use it as the combination between what you call the prediction horizon and the optimization horizon. So I don't know if I have understand you that control scheme you are making. Let me try to explain, or how did I understand it? And can you please correct me if not? If you can put the slide where you,
which one?
You know, the figure where you explain your control scheme with the time frames.
This one?
Yes, that's it. Perfect. You have the same one in the thesis.
Yes.
So I have understood that you first, when this is running, you have already calculated a number of steps.
Yep.
Called what you call the control horizon. So you have a sequence already calculated from the previous step, and you start applying it.
Yeah.
Is that so correct?
Yeah.
So while you are starting applying it, you in parallel are computing the next batch.
Yeah.
Using what you call the prediction horizon. Is that okay?
I predict what where we will be at the end of this step. Yeah. And then I will perform the optimization from this new point.
Okay.
So because I know what will be the input on this time slot, for all this sample time, I know what will be the input, so I can do a simple prediction, which can be performed very quickly compared to the optimization. And then from this new point, I will perform all the optimization, but knowing from the future. It's like predicting the next step while still doing the previous step.
Yeah, that's what I. So, in practice, when do you update the controller inputs? It's not each step, for what I understand. So this optimization loop.
Yeah.
Maybe I did understand it wrongly. So you, what you, I understood that that you updated this after the prediction horizon. You update all controller inputs. So no, it's a time step or sample time.
No, I update this at each sample time.
Okay.
Yeah, at each sample time, it does all of this. This is and of course, depending on the way the optimization is built, we can, for example, give the information as you said that this input will be given for a certain duration of time and use all this duration of time for computation if needed. But this is similar to directly modifying the sample time for us.
Okay, I don't know if I understand this correctly. So it's like a normal MPC. There's no, you each time step compute all the time steps ahead and apply the first one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just that it does not does it for the moment right after, but the one after this one, because we already know where we will be meanwhile. This is the only difference. There's no Otherwise, it's a typical MPC.
Okay, so you are like shifted in time. So in reality, that's what I told you are applying a control input that it's pre-calculated some time ago.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. This is necessary to give more time to compute everything. Yeah.
But you are introducing there a time lag, which I assume is acceptable for the dynamics of your system, because you are working open loop with information from the past.
Well, yes, because the dynamics of what we want to control is very slow compared to our sample time. We consider that there is no issue here related to that. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So, regarding some of the phenomena you have, for instance, this strategy obviously will lead to differences, small differences between your reality and your prediction. And maybe, I mean, referring to the, I don't know, expert on the coupling between reactive power and so on, but in my experience, when you have this kind of issues on MPC controller, is because you have some issue with the model. You can have some issue with the model. Maybe the model has not included all the terms that you should, or there's a slight error that it's accumulated in your horizon and leads to this kind of phenomena. So maybe it's interesting to try to see if that's the case.
Absolutely.
Then, another comment to question is, I can think they have already mentioned, but you have in the future, it's planned, or the future world will include to experimentally test all this, which obviously is complex. Or we all know experimentation is complex and reality is really hard. you are in all the document, you are talking about computational efficiency, the computational burden, all the predictive control. It's quite heavy on that, we already know.
Yep.
Even if you have to do great work optimizing it. So you have thought that you have even programmed this in C++.
Yeah.
So how much time does it require? I don't know. It's a kind of, I know you haven't implemented it really, but maybe it's possible to optimize this. How many microseconds could you achieve?
What we achieved, we did two tests, one with physical, what's the name? But in the laboratory, we have a physical controller, which is very high performance, and we implemented it, Opal RT, and we implemented it in this control algorithm inside, but without the communication. So the communication was not taken into account. And I think we used, when we had a sample time of 100 microseconds, we needed between 50 and 80 with a control horizon of two steps, with only two steps. When we go to three, we go further than the 100 microseconds allowed. Mm-hmm. So there's still some progress to be made here.
Okay, but what are the within the range that you are tracking?
Yeah. Okay. It seems feasible, but so far it's quite difficult to ensure, because the running time is not known exactly, and it can change when we change the cost function. It can change when we change the topology and the number of possibilities. So it's a bit complicated to ensure that in every case this will be feasible, but with the NPC case with 27 possibilities at each step, it was feasible for a control step of two sample times, and from three and onward it was very just. Like three was I think between 90 something and 180, so it's a big difference between the two steps, but so there is still some progress to be made on this implementation of the algorithm.
Okay. Just as a comment, for example, when you try to implement other approaches like non-linear MPC, which is highly computational heavy, it has high computational cost also, people usually try to be non I know the optimal is not found, but a suboptimal solution that can be found in a limited frame. So that maybe in this rough set, you can like combine the Dijkstra with maybe a greedy algorithm if you are running out of time.
Yeah, it's possible.
Could be an idea. It's a very, very interesting idea, the graph-based formulation for this specific kind. You are able to include constraints there, but I think I have read in your document that you haven't. So my question is, constraints are when things complicate in model predictive control. Have you made some tests regarding constraint? Maybe you have talked, maybe excluding some combination that maybe, I don't know, unstable or so on?
In fact, the constraints were, I've tried some constraints, mostly not on the possibilities in the tree of possibility, but more in the, well, it blocks possibilities, but it was mostly used in function of, for example, if the voltage is higher than some value, we cannot go there and so on. It worked correctly. The main issue is the global feasibility of it all, because this is one of the issues we've had most of the time, is sometimes we asked some impossible things to the controller, and because we kept asking it to do impossible things, it gave some very bad results or very strange results, difficult to understand. And so for the moment, we decided to say, okay, you can do anything you want, and we'll see if it works in this frame before constraining the frame. But yeah, this is it has not been tested in a complex situation, but in a simple situation where we know what we can do, what we cannot do, very precisely, because sometimes it was not as precise as that. It is there is no issue when implementing these constraints, and in fact, it gives the controller, it makes it faster because it directly limits the possibilities in the tree of possibilities. Because instead of having, for example, the 27 possibilities, it will have only 20 because 7 of them are impossible, and so it will, it will change the size of the tree in a way. So it was interesting, but when we tried simulations with more complex situations and when we had more different objectives combined together and more variables and everything, it was a bit messy. So we decided to not implement it on these examples. Yeah.
Okay. In fact, my next question was related with one phenomena that you have mentioned. It is true that when you enter the constraints, the MPC starts to give these kind of problems. In fact, more important than the stability in model predictive control is feasibility, which is in fact that when you introduce constraints, you may not have a solution because you are asking the impossible. Typical solution is to increase the horizon, which is obviously with an infinite horizon, you will live or go where you want, which is where you have then the problem of computational cost or. And I am glad that you have tried that you have made that test. For me, it would be have been interesting to see them in the thesis, because I think that's where the MPC starts to be, the most. Well, that has all its potential. I think those constraints and to try to see what problems they have, it has, and the future line is to solve that. Obviously, which is very complicated.
It's very difficult to see the impact it will have in the end. So it was a bit, and because the idea was first to prove that it was able to handle the switching actions and everything all together, we decided to not make it too complicated at the very beginning. So yeah, of course there is still a lot of things to try.
I think I have already my time slot, so congratulations again, and thank you very much for your answers.
Thank you,
Achier. Now, Professor Briat, Olivier, la parole est à vous, in French or in English, as you want.
Thank you, Cédric. Do you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the supervisor to invite me to his PhD defense. Mr. Jupin, thank you for your presentation. I am not a specialist in control, so I have some short basic questions.
Okay.
I had a question on MPC implementation, but this one has been already discussed. So my first question is related to the last chapter of your thesis.
Mm-hmm.
When you present the validation of MPC control on several applications, I understood that you use the same state space representation of a converter and for the controller. Is it true?
It's not exactly true, because the converter that we modeled in the Simulink part was made with real switches, but we considered them as ideal in the models. So this is the main difference between the two ones. But otherwise, they should be the same. I mean, but we used the Simulink models and not the switch state space representation to perform as the model, for the system. But otherwise, yes, they should be the same.
Okay. From your point of view, is there an interest to make a co-simulation with a real circuit simulator? For example, SPICE or another one?
I see. I think
to use a more accurate model for the switches.
Yeah, it could be interesting, especially because at the very beginning, what we considered studying the losses inside the converter. And so we wanted to have this very specific model that will be able to give us the losses from, for example, the commutation or the conduction losses. And because the model we used in these simulations do not include this information, it would be, in fact, very interesting to have a more precise and accurate simulation tool to actually see correctly this impact and these losses, for example.
The efficiency of water could be taken into account in the cost function another question. In the last chapter, also, it seems the parameters of the cost function are chosen in an empirical way.
Yep. Yeah.
Is there a methodology to tune these parameters by taking into account, for example, stability and robustness?
Mm-hmm. When it comes to the tuning of the cost function, you're absolutely right. It's mostly empirical. The only thing we know is that when we increase separately from all the others, the coefficient related to one subcost, we increase the importance of the subcost in the global cost function. And then we just have to juggle with all of these subcosts. And this is one of the main issues with this controller, is that even if we have all the separate control requirements expressed directly in the cost function, we do not necessarily know very precisely how they will cooperate between each other. Like sometimes two subcosts are battling against each other, and so we have to find the good compromise. And it's easy to we can do it when it's only two of them. But when there is when there are three, four, five objectives together, it's a bit more difficult to tune it correctly. And so far, I think it could be possible to to make it automatic. But I don't know how to do it right now. I could not do it another way than manually. But yeah, I think it's possible to give more ways to understand how the impact of this waiting, what the impact of this waiting will have on the general sensitivity and robustness and everything. But so far, I cannot express it theoretically, so I can only do it empirically so far.
Okay, yeah, I understand this is a complex problem.
Yeah.
I don't have no more questions.
Okay.
Merci, Olivier. Then it's my turn now as a referee here in this thesis to ask some questions, but the exercise is very difficult to me because I'm a specialist of everything and nothing. As usual, the chairman must be like that. But I think I have two remarks or three remarks. First remark is a reproach. You know, I congratulated you and so on and so on. I'm very kind with you, but I have a point which is very important. I used to say that in every jury in France. There is no any targeting the French research on the domain. I mean, the French research is very rich in the domain of modeling and control power electronic systems, but the references you put are very poor. This is just a reproach and I think an advice for the future. It's very important to show to the world what we are doing in France as well, okay?
yeah.
It's very important. You can see in Aalborg University, I'm speaking under control of Florin. When I check some publication or some thesis from Aalborg, I can see a lot of publications from this university. This is important for us to show our activities as well. Okay, this is a reproach, but everybody in France used to do that. France is not important, but I'm a Frenchman now today.
No, I understand. I mean, so the fact is, because we search for everything in English, sometimes we just forget about the nationality.
Now,
yeah?
Now you have a huge activities in English language as well.
Yeah.
We have just one conference in France, which is completely French.
Yeah.
Okay, it's the Symposium of Génétique. Hein?
Yeah.
But other conferences, I met you many times.
Yeah. Yeah, I know.
No excuse.
Yeah.
The second one is, I think you have not answered clearly to Professor Xu's question about the definition of weak grid. The weak grid is defined by short circuit ratio. Yes, this is the main definition. When the short circuit ratio is poor, it means that the voltages are not robust again, any disturbance and so on. And there is a very interesting point in this definition in presence of power electronic systems. Power electronic systems, if you have well-controlled inverter, for instance, the short circuit could be infinite on the domain of the existence. But if you are reaching the limits, it's very complicated. This is that to take it in mind. It's very important. I understand that, of course, why the title is not exactly fulfilling with the PhD dissertation. Maybe if you vote here about the title, it could be completely different. Okay?
Yeah.
Then I have now a set of questions. The first of them is related to globally your control. I'm a guy from, as I said, I know everything, but nothing else. Then my question could be stupid. But you have the right to react for my remark. My remark is, I can consider that, as Professor Xu said, the frequency is free here. It's a free frequency control, isn't it? Okay. Then can I consider that your control is a variable structure control? I mean, a sliding mode control with a complex manifold, I think a complex surface of commutation. Then, really, I thought about that, it's possible. And then I can maybe schedule all the rules related to the sliding mode control. I mean, the existence of the control, as Ashley said, beyond the robustness and so on, is the feasibility, but the feasibility can translate it mathematically on the domain of the existence of this control. Okay, then I can go more for stability and stability issues, I can check the what could be the stability by putting a control, an equivalent control, which is calculated straightforwardly, and then I can check the internal dynamic or zero dynamics. What's your opinion about that? You have the right to react, of course. Politely, because I'm a professor.
I'm not sure I understood everything correctly, so I will try to react anyway.
The main idea behind is a variable structure control. Okay, based on a PC or something, based on more complex, formulation of the surface. You know, inside the mode control, you used to work with very simple example, boost converter. Okay, you have a surface which is the error regarding the constant reference and so on, but it could be more complex than that. This is just maybe remark. Is it possible to be dug more intensively in order maybe to generate more knowledge? This is a remark and advice. Okay.
Of course, there is a lot of things that are not completely, that were not completely explained and studied correctly. Well, not correctly, no. Far enough, I will say, for this form of controller, and especially one of the main problems that still remain, and we can find it in the literature also, with this kind of optimization algorithms, it's very difficult to talk about the feasibility and to express the global stability of the control system. It's very, very difficult because of the form of the optimization used inside. The usual methods can be used, but it's very unpractical for this situation, for this MPC situation. And yeah, the thing is, we can add a lot of information inside. This is always possible in the cost function in particular, because this
maybe
is where we add.
Yes, maybe if I can apply with, I can simplify the problem by putting your gamma function equal to zero, the minimum value. I put it as a minimum value, and from that, I can extract an equivalent control. And this equivalent control is continuous one, and it could be applied for the averaged model for your system, and then you can check stability issues and robustness issues.
Now I understand. Okay.
This is a path for your future research.
Okay.
Your next, for your future PhD students. You are going to supervise certainly.
Okay.
This is the interesting question about what if you have to change something and so on, what would be your new approach? The experience you have. Other something that is disturbed me is the models. Used linear models, but I have no idea about the accuracy of the linearization process. Okay, it means that the operating point is changing, of course. Just with this control, it changed. Then if it changed, the linear model is changing as well.
Yeah.
Because linear model is all about an operating point. Is there some...
No. Problems? I mean, on this case, on the examples we talked about, it was not linearized. It was already linear at the beginning because we use only LC and LCL filter. No. So it's
the structure which is used is linear. I mean, your matrix R is depending on time and control.
But
the structure you used, it means it's affine at the input. It's affine on state. For me, this is the okay. It's it can be considered as AX plus B. U, where A and B are depending on the parameters. What I said about that.
Yeah. I think I understand now. I think because when we change from one parameter to the other, we do not know exactly what happens at the moment of the change. Yeah. I think this is what you want to say.
Yes.
And in this work we did this hypothesis that there was no problem with it, and we said it was continuous by part, and just having, steps and sometimes. But the thing is, It's mostly because of the speed of the sample time is very fast compared to all the dynamics in the rest.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Because we are in microseconds compared to dynamics, which are more in the tens of seconds, I will say. So we consider as a general hypothesis, which could be contested, and we could, we would want to test it mm-hmm. and to challenge it, but we said as an hypothesis that there was no issue with this switching operation, with the moment we change.
I accept that, no problem. Many other points related to the accuracy and so on. You know, simulations, okay, it could mm-hmm. be perfect, but you can add in the simulation process some uncertainties, some disturbances, noise, and so on and so on.
Yeah.
And what is the main, during your sensitivity studies here?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you did that by experiment, changing this and changing that, adding this and adding that. What would be the influence on the control? What is the main disturbance which affects your control from your point of view or your experience? Donc parmi tous les systèmes de perturbation que vous avez essayé, donc tu as essayé dans tes simulations, quel est le facteur qui influence le plus négativement ton résultat?
Negatively. No, when I think about the different tests, I mean, when it comes to sensitivity, it's very important because it's very, the tuning is very difficult and precise. But when it comes to other elements, like elements coming from the sensors or coming from the models, we've seen that robustness is pretty good. However, if the measures do not illustrate correctly the state of the system, we start from a wrong point, and then everything else is wrong. So there is a big problem here. We have to be very cautious about the way the sensors and the measures are performed. Yeah,
this is the main. There a possibility? Yes, is a possibility to correct this error, because you have a model, and you have measurements, and you have observers, and you can maybe play with these three assets in order to reject this uncertainties. Is it possible?
Well, I will answer very generally, I think, but here the system. There is only the MPC controller, but there could be something of higher level that will clean the different signals and everything. So yeah. Here it's only performing as itself alone in the control structure, and I think it is not because of this control horizon, which is very short, and because of many other limitations on the prediction horizon of the controller. Many things like cleaning the signals and I don't know, like studying the energy flow and other things like that, could and should be done by another block that is superior to this one. It is a very low
outer
level controller.
Outer.
Yeah.
An outer one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But accept this answer. Good. Another very dangerous, ignored sometimes aspect. For any grid side converters is the PLL.
Mm-hmm.
I think your PLL has been chosen perfect.
Well, there
in
fact, there is not really a PLL used by the controller. It does not use anyone.
If you want to inject reactive power, you need to have an idea about the phase.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
This
I mean,
this is the idea of PLL. It's not
I think I said it. I said it a bit wrong. Yeah, I said it a bit wrong. I mean, this information on, if you remember, I mean, I should have it somewhere.
Maybe I'm a very old man, you know. I can't.
No. Just, I think it's here. So
yes,
if you can see here, the references are very important for that. The UR, US, and UT are very important. And yes, these ones were obtained considering that we have the information on the system. So yes, here there is a facility. I mean, there is something here that, because the controller itself does not use any PLL or anything like that. However, when we generate the references, yes, we have, we generate them using the knowledge we have on the system. And this is why I say this controller is not adapted to functioning alone. It should be combined with something more higher level that will find the PLL, that will find the frequency and the angle of the signals, and that will be able to generate the correct signals to follow.
Thank you. Absolutely. It's good. It's thank you very much for this answer. It's clear for me. Two other questions. I think I can. I have 10 minutes. I gave for myself 10 minutes. It reminds me 2 minutes.
Okay. Maybe. Okay.
Another general question: the family, the converters families you presented here, there is missing one of them, very important one, especially when you mentioned that middle voltage, high voltage, or middle power, high power, is the modular multi-level controller, which is very popular today.
Yeah.
Why did you ignore it or in your just during the presentation?
Yeah.
The Swiss tool, the Swiss knife for everything now, for middle and high voltage applications.
Yeah, of course. I mean, modular multi-level converters are like the force family I explained here.
Very interesting. Very interesting set for application for your methods.
Yeah. I mean,
we have some. There are some related MPC controllers dedicated to that.
Yeah, absolutely. But the thing is, when we I will start again. Modular multi-level converters is like a whole new branch, and there is a lot of different MMCs forms and all of that. And so when we try to select the topologies we wanted to study and to test, of course, all the family of modular multi-level converters is very interesting, especially because it can do some DC-DC, AC-DC. It can do many different things. It's very flexible, powerful family or subfamily of multi-level power converters. But the thing is, often they are a combination of diode clamps and prime capacitors and CHBs. The way they are modulated, I will say, they are a combination of all different parts. And in a way, if we can control the different parts, we can extend the results. Well, of course, we would have to test it and to do it more in details. But the idea is that if we can do all these other ones, we can most likely do it also for modular multi-level converters. But yeah, I mean, it's
careful with that, because the balancing control algorithm is you can apply it for this, but the balancing control algorithm here is one of the key point. You have to balance the energy between arms, between submodels, same.
Absolutely.
So it's a bit complicated.
Yeah, of course it is complicated, but I think
it could be worthy.
Yeah.
It's not a simple way to apply that, but it would be a very, very interesting application for your work.
Yeah,
and the last, I'm just intrigued by the slide 49.
49.
I don't remember.
49.
The last one about the loads. I have really
about the loads.
Yes, 49 with the converter and the scheme, the general scheme of the converter, and 49 maybe. 49e, je crois. Non, pas 49e. Non. Continue. Ah, this one.
This one. Yep.
Remonte. Non, remonte. No, not this one. Remonte. Voilà.
This one?
Okay. I see resistors in series with capacitors in the IC side. I'm not intrigued. What is that?
The idea was to model in a way different kinds of loads. So in these situations, we had the three resistances were different and the three capacities were different, and wanted to say, okay, if this is a battery or if this is some kind of other element, even if it has a capacity element, even if it has a resistive element, we can still adapt and control even without having this information. The controller does not know what is behind that. Yeah.
You can put inside the current generator,
source. Yeah, in a way.
It's more general. Okay. Good. I'm intrigued by that. Thank you very much. really, I appreciated our exchanges. Then now I move to the supervision staff, Yonel Tapia, you can start, everyone, you want. Tapia or Yonen. You can answer from question, make some remarks, maybe some question, additional questions, please.
Please let us know you can hear, if you can hear us.
Yes, yes, clearly.
We have some return here.
There is return?
There is no echo. It's perfect from. I switch.
Is it okay now? Okay, I just don't hear him. Oui, mais moi je sais pas moi. ok.
On vous entend très bien.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, it's only for us, but.
Okay, I'm afraid that my contribution is not going to be especially interesting because I just want to say some good words for everybody. So I will start with the jury. So I would like to thank you so much for agreeing to be part of this international top level jury. Very close to the subject of the thesis, which was evidenced by the good questions and the remarks and the very accurate comments regarding the thesis of Samuel, which will help him and us probably to follow with his work ahead. So thank you very much to all of you.
Thank you, Gerardo.
Yeah, it is nice words. You spend a lot of time reading the thesis, and it became evident here. And I want to thank you so much for this.
It's a privilege and honor and pleasure. Really. It's very interesting work. Thank you. Thank you very much, Gerardo.
Okay.
Yonel? Well, thank you. Yonel?
Let's see some more things about...
Please.
Like to highlight something about Samuel is his honesty, personal honesty, and a scientific honesty, which was evident also in this presentation. If he doesn't know something, he says it very clearly. He's also a very intelligent person, as you saw. Has good initiative. The idea of applying MPC was his idea, because my original idea was to use slide mode control. But I saw him so convinced that I let him go. And my help in this thesis was almost just to... Sorry, because they have a big return here, and it's a bit difficult for me.
We understand,
see that everything was correct, and that his ideas were correct. And just to help him with the methodology, the didactical part. Not so much control, especially because I'm not an expert in this. He was very autonomous at first.
Bernardo, and I'd like to congratulate you personally for this first PhD defense and student, really. Interesting work and perfect for me from my point of view, and very open in terms of problems and in terms of perspectives. I wish you the best for the future.
Actually, Erasmus speaks about me as a first.
PhD. Aye. After 10, after 15. No, thank you, baby. Please, Lionel, continue.
So, Samuel.
The usage in France is to give words for any PhD present on the room. If there any PhD who wants to participate, ask, or make remark, if it's not the case.
Sadiq, I think you have to be precise. You speak about your rooms,
your wives,
or...
No. My daughter is in the first floor working on with a remote professor, with you. No usage if there is participants. I don't see any participant who has the degree of PhD has the right to ask and participate. This is the usage in France, but there is no one. Okay.
It's the same in Spain.
Yeah. Yes.
We'll try to see if somebody has a question.
Yes.
It seems that it was very clear. Yeah.
Very well. Many thanks. Yes. Okay. I can conclude with this presentation, question, session, and I will have to move now in another virtual room for the debate in order to provide the decision, final decision for this PhD. But I need just to ask Gerardo and Lionel to follow us before the debate, because there is some documents which has to be fulfilled, needs to be more explained. Is it possible to have Lionel and Gerardo in the first part of defense in the other room? Please, follow us.
So if I well understood, Cedric, you would like to be in the other room also?
Yes, just at the beginning, in order to check the documents together.
Of course, no problem.
There is some uncertainties, some misunderstanding.
We'll join you, and we will ask.
You will leave after. You will leave after, before the debate. You will leave. Okay. Join us, please.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
say. Yep. Attends, je ne mets pas du bon côté. Ok. Yeah, I'm here. I'm ready. Okay.
Nous ne jugeons pas l'ensemble, l'ensemble étant jugé d'ailleurs, le manuscrit a été jugé par les rapporteurs et les conclusions étaient favorables. Là, nous ne jugeons que votre prestation aujourd'hui. Ce que nous avons apprécié, c'est la qualité qui a été à la fois pédagogique, sur un ton très compréhensible en anglais, ce qui fait quand même c'est une difficulté supplémentaire. Les supports étaient de qualité, bien choisis, et vous avez ciblé les points essentiels, les saillants scientifiques de votre travail. Ceci est d'autant plus méritoire que vous êtes à cheval sur deux disciplines, sur des problèmes assez complexes. Et là, ça a permis au jury justement d'intervenir sur un large panel, ce qui est très important à mentionner, de questions allant de l'automatique presque théorique sur les aspects variété différentielle, etc. Je ne sais pas si vous avez vu, on en a parlé, jusqu'à des aspects d'implémentation physique, donc des algorithmes que vous avez développés. Vous avez répondu avec aisance, clarté et justesse. Là, vous avez démontré que votre maîtrise est évidente par rapport au sujet que vous avez développé, et par là, après une discussion très très rapide et de manière unanime, nous avons décidé de vous attribuer le titre de docteur de l'Université de Bordeaux. En France, il n'y a pas de mention, mais il y aura une mention après, côté espagnol, bien sûr. On verra par la suite un autre jugement qui ne posera certainement pas de problème. Alors, permettez-moi de vous féliciter en mon nom, bien sûr, en tant que président, mais surtout au nom de tout le jury pour votre très agréable, intéressante et belle prestation et vous souhaite le meilleur pour la suite.
Merci.
Merci. If you have some words to add after that.
Well, of course. So I did not prepare anything, so I will be brief. So I would like to thank, really, I'm very, very grateful for all the members of the jury for being here today. It's really an honor for me to be able to work with you and to see you finally after all these works. I would like to thank my directors, of course, because without them, I think this would not be as good as it is right now. They managed to guide me, and I know sometimes I'm a bit special, I will say. So I really thank you for them for that. I would like to thank all the people that could be here and those that could not be here, that made this thesis more comfortable for me, that made it easier, that made it, yes, possible in the end. And of course, I think I will switch to French very quickly here. Donc, je voudrais remercier aussi, en particulier, bien entendu, tous les membres de ma famille qui regardent probablement ce live ici et maintenant, Et effectivement, encore une fois, un grand merci à tous les membres du jury, mes directeurs et toutes les personnes qui ont pu venir et toutes celles qui n'ont pas pu venir, qui m'ont vraiment supporté tout au long de ces 4 années de thèse. Vraiment, merci. Merci beaucoup.
Bien, bravo. OK, I think my role as a president is finished now. I have another role. I have to complete all the forms, but I take I remain in contact with Yonel for that. At the beginning of the afternoon, Yonel, if you are ready, we can exchange about that, okay? And I invite everybody to send the vote to the Spanish part, okay? And I hope we can meet together around a table sharing Rioja wines in the close future.
Voilà. Hopefully.
Thank you very much, everybody. Yonel, it's okay?
Thank you very much, Cedric. Thank you very much to all. And this will be our job to choose a good Rioja for the next opportunity.
Duty, big duty.
I just wanted to add a couple of things.
Yes, please.
I want to send the greetings to Martinez issue to Professor Hsu. And the greetings from Bacha. I don't know if you
yes, I'm a native. I'm a Basque native guy.
This is it, eh? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
See the contrast in the head? This is before and this is after. You cannot see my smile, but
but it is here. I
yeah.
believe.
Docteur, je touche la main. Félicitations.